I'd like to welcome to the stage our first speaker on the case study for the topic, the third topic we're talking about, Sarah Gibbs, the co-founder of Trilogy. Now, Sarah worked in corporate finance in Hong Kong, South Africa and London before coming home to New Zealand to run her own company manufacturing ingredients for the natural cosmetics and supplements market. Sarah established her natural skincare brand Trilogy with her sister Catherine de Groot 10 years ago. It started small, and as Sarah herself has said, she struck oil, rosehip oil to be exact, her first major product, and she developed a new way to extract the purest elements from it. And the rest, as they say, is history. Trilogy now boasts 40 products and is now a respected international brand sold in 3,500 stores in 16 international markets. Sarah also sits on the executive boards of Ekoya, Export New Zealand, and the Cosmetic Toiletry and Fragrance Association. She has learned who her customers are and how to promote the differences of her brand in a very competitive and very crowded market. Sarah's well qualified to talk about successful marketing through planning, persistence, and a small budget. Welcome, Sarah.
Thank you, Laura Lee, for that introduction. I've been doing a little bit of public speaking this year, and by and large, I'm speaking with men in general. So whilst I'm up here and don't have the research budget of Intel, I thought I might just do a bit of a survey on the men as to who actually uses skincare in Christchurch. Is anyone game? Are you the Christchurch man to own up? Pete? Someone up the back? It's a poor offering compared to the Aucklanders. And I'm not really surprised by that. Hey, and the other thing that's cool about being here is the first person that I ever actually sold anything to is at this conference, Bob Hardy. First person to ever buy anything off me and trust me is here. So hi, Bob. What I thought I might do today is tell you quickly a bit about the company, why we started Trilogy and how we started it, and then talk to you about my five C's for innovative market entry. I normally talk about the five P's, but I'm tired of those. So today you're going to get five C's for innovative market entry. Trilogy, as Laura Lee said, is a 10-year-old company. We're a natural skincare brand based on rosehip oil. Started with my sister, Kath de Groot, in 2002, literally in a shed in Trentham. So we're not L'Oreal from Paris, we are Trilogy from Trentham. I think that's got a nice little ring to it, don't you? It's probably why we got our competitive advantage. We now employ over 30 staff across three offices, Wellington, Melbourne and London. And we're actually sold in 4,000 outlets these days, Laura Lee. So in the last year, obviously, since the briefing notes that you received, we've picked up 500 new accounts somewhere here or there. 15 countries around the world, one major continent, Antarctica. That's my account, Antarctica. I'm the account manager for that business. I'm not delegating that role to anyone else. It's massive turnover, about $500 a year. So should I be able to convince my board that, you know, I think it's about 20K, isn't it, to go to Antarctica? Should I be able to convince my board that the return on investment is worthwhile? You'll see me blogging from Antarctica in the near future. Incidentally, Antarctica took the Trilogy brand on because we have a natural and ethical base to us, a fundamental of our marketing strategy. Since we started the company, we started the first stockist for our brand was a organic supermarket in Wellington called Common Sense Organics. Now, if you go to any of our major markets, the UK, for example, you'll find us in Boots, you'll find us in Selfridges, you'll find us in House of Fraser. If you go to Japan, you'll find us in Isetan. If you go to Australia, you'll find us in Myer, etc., etc. So, good old Bob Hardy, my first ever customer in Common Sense Organics. For getting us underway and believing in us. So my five C's for market entry. Let's start with the one that every small company lacks, and that's cash. And Kath and I started Trilogy with $25,000. So the first C, cash, is, you know, or lack of. And what we did with our $25,000 was to develop what we call an outsourced business model. It's fairly typical now of particularly product-based brands. Your 42 Below started this way, Icebreaker started this way, and that's that we really outsource everything that isn't a core skill. It meant that, so we don't do our own manufacturing, we don't do our own formulation, we don't do our own distribution, and we don't do our own selling. We're basically a marketing company. And that enabled us to get underway using our core skill being marketing, without investing money in capital, plant equipment, and having a heavy balance sheet with a lot of debt. It gave the business massive flexibility from day one, and we still run this model 10 years on. We still outsource our sales and distribution, for example, because it gives the company fantastic flexibility in our P&L. You can tell I'm an accountant now, can't you? I was trying to hide that. No offence to any other accountants here, because we're quite cool, aren't we? So that was a great way to start the business with not a lot of money. The other thing that we thought seriously about was how to market with no money. And if you consider that it costs $15,000 to place one ad once on a third of a page in one Australian newspaper, $25,000 isn't going to get you far, is it? So what we call consumer marketing, we all know as consumer marketing, was not going to be a plan for Trilogy. So we adopted our own trade marketing techniques. Neither Catherine and I come from a beauty background, which in itself was extremely advantageous because we weren't looking to what the norm was. We had to create our own norm. And so we established a very, very micro, very, very complex trade marketing strategy, starting with our suppliers and ensuring that, you know, supply through the market was always guaranteed by superb relationships with our suppliers. And just because you're paying someone doesn't mean you have the control. I think the supplier relationship must be a partnership, and we don't see enough of that. So our suppliers are our best friends. Then we move to our distributors and the sales forces that work with us, and they are our second best friends. And, you know, again, it's L-O-V-E, get them to love you, and they'll work for you, and they'll promote your product over and above others. So particularly important offshore when you're slightly distanced from your market, that they can feel your love and that you're getting it back. Then you've got your retailers. That's an easy one. Give them a deal, and they'll love you. And then you've got retail staff. That's quite an easy one too. Give them free product, in our case, and they'll love you. And we run a very successful sales incentive scheme in all of our key markets, where when sales consultants on the floor of a pharmacy or a department store sell a certain amount of Trilogy, they can send their receipts back to our offices and say, can I have a free product of any product they like in our range? We then write them a handwritten note, send them that free product, and then tell them something else that's going on that might interest them or that might entice them to sell further or to spread the word more. We call it the sales incentive scheme, and we have full-time staff in all three offices processing sales rewards, sales incentives for our retail staff. So a couple of years ago, I had to work out a way of disincentivising the incentive scheme. It was out of control. We spend about $150,000 a year on that scheme now. So that's what's that? That's 10 ads in one Australian newspaper. Far more effective than 10 ads in one Australian newspaper. We finally do get to the consumer, and the way that Trilogy has targeted the consumer has been through public relations, PR, fundamentally. And in six of our key markets, we retain public relations companies to promote our product on a monthly basis out to beauty journalists, business journalists, primarily beauty and business journalists. And you know, if you can get in a magazine, great. If you can get in the newspaper, fantastic. And if you can get on TV, you've got a run. You know, your product's on a run. So we believe PR is probably the best consumer marketing technique for a business like ours, because journalists are looking for a story, and if you've got something unique, you've got a unique product or service proposition, they want to hear about it, so tell them the story and they'll promote you, and then it'll be free. My second C is courage, and it's really hard work, as you all know, to export. You know, it takes real guts and a hell of a lot of energy. Peter was just telling me before he spoke that he travels 4 days out of five. So he's at home one day a week. And it takes real energy and real guts to be able to do that and do that consistently, but that's what you've got to do. I also think it's about developing strategy, staying on it and executing it, and executing it and executing it. And to give you a good example of this, in 2008, we had 89 export inquiries at Trilogy. Only one of them fitted our strategy, so we only took one of them. We only took one of the inquiries and followed it through to execution. So you've got to be really narrow-minded, In our case, you know, our strategy is to be deep and narrow into our markets rather than, you know, broad and thin, and just sort of, you know, we're in 50 countries, whoop-de-doo, we're not selling anything in, much in them anyway. You'd better to be deep and narrow and very focused on your export strategy. Because to enter a market's one thing, as I always say, to get your product on the shelf is one thing, to sell it off into someone's bathroom is another thing. That's the hard part. So you can't underestimate, you know, if Boots ring you and say, we're going to stock your product, that's one thing. That's the easy part compared to actually then getting a customer to go and buy that product, use it and use it again. The other thing I think about courage that's really important is that balance between patience and persistence. And they're kind of juxtaposed, aren't they, patience and persistence. And, you know, I struggle a lot with one of them, actually. I'm way better at the other one. So they're a balancing act, and they don't sit well together. But in our case, you know, there's 25,000 skincare brands available to the market. So if you're too patient, you miss the boat. And if you're too persistent, you annoy them, and they move on to one of the other 25,000 brands. So it's a real balancing act. And to give you a good example, when we first started Trilogy, about a month after we launched in Australia and New Zealand at the same time. You can talk to me separately about whether that was a good idea or not. And within a month, I approached a major Australian retailer and said, hi, I'm Sarah from Trilogy, wondering if you want to stock our product. And rightly so, the buyer said to me, you know, who are you? Where are you from? Are you going to, you know, virtually said, you know, you're going to row it over in a canoe? Not, you know, thinking that we're totally unsophisticated, and at that stage we probably were. And she said, look, I'm not interested. I get a brand a week approaching me, and I have 10 brands on shelf. So, you know, go away and convince me that you've actually got something going on. So she's the buyer at a major department store. I accept that she knows what she's talking about. So I left her for a couple of months, but I had the door just open. I didn't let her close the door on me. I left the door just open and rang her back. And every time I rang her, I'd say, can I have a meeting? She'd say no, but I'd give her some product, or I'd send her some press that we'd got, or I'd inform her of some new markets that we developed in. Just be telling her something about the brand and keeping Trilogy in her head. And this went on for 14 months. And I, you know, rang up, I think it was February 2004, and I rang her up and said, can I have a meeting? She said, yes. Okay, this is good. So I went along to the meeting. I thought to myself by then, I don't think I need to sell to her. She's seen enough of me. She's heard enough of me. I've probably been a bit too persistent. Yeah, I'll just go in and ask her, so, you know enough about Trilogy. We're just wondering what you're looking for in your skincare category. And she said, we're looking for brands like yours. Let's roll you out to 30 stores next month. So I just kept myself together and, you know, high-fived myself in the lift as I got out and went back to the office and had a big party. So that whole, you know, courage balance with patience and persistence, I think, is really, really important in exporting. And I have to say, that scenario has pretty much played out with every major retailer that we work with in the world. We would expect 18 months to 2 years before we launch, before we're successful in securing and launching within a major retail partner. My third C, I think it's my third, is creativity, a point of difference. And I really mean that not just with our product, but with our people. And if any of you have heard me speaking before, you probably know that for me it's all about people. And let me just give you some attributes of a Trilogy staff member, because I think these attributes represent someone that is able to create a product and to export it. So we like creative people. We like people that are left or right of centre, and we like real, true individuals. We like positivity. We just don't do negative attitude well at Trilogy. It's not an option. We like givers, not takers. We like people with their glass half full, not half empty. And on Friday night, we like their glass to be completely full. If you don't like change, don't take a job with us. And we like people that look at opportunities not with fear or more work, but with excitement. Exactly what Peter just alluded to. You know, fear of missing opportunities is what our team think about. We like risk takers, and we like people that are really memorable. We like, you know, a quirk factor. Because, as I said earlier, there's 25,000 skincare brands in the world. You'd better bet that you need to be memorable when you go and meet a major retail partner. partner for the future. So that's what we're looking for in our team, and that's what we've got. I can say the whole 30 plus staff at Trilogy have those traits really ingrained in them, and that's how we hire. We're basically hiring attitude. Some roles obviously require particular skills, but fundamentally we're hiring the attitude as much as we're hiring the skill. And we've been really, really successful at upskilling people who have the right attitude. So you don't need to be hiring people on 100k plus off the bat. You can hire someone on 40k and have them earning 100k within 3 or 4 years, having learnt, you know, your technique and your style. So creativity, I think, in terms of not just product, because that goes without saying, we all know that, but creativity within your team is imperative to be successful in exporting. My fourth C, culture. And culture eats strategy for breakfast. If you don't have culture, you may as well not have strategy, you may as well not have execution. It's the backbone of our business. And in terms of our export culture, we had to work quite hard, actually, to create a culture that meant our team looked out at the world and looked out at our markets. We had real problems in the early days with the team in Wellington, which is the head office, looking out the window of Wellington down Lambton Quay and assuming that that's what it was like in Sydney or London or Dublin or Hong Kong or Tokyo. And of course, you know, Wellington's our home market. We absolutely hum there. We're in about 10 stores along Lambton Quay. We've got, you know, 5 shelves with the number one brand. It's just not like that in the rest of the world. So we had a lot of trouble getting our team to understand that we don't look and feel like this on the shelf in our other markets. In Australia, for example, we'd be lucky if we hold 2 shelves, for example, in our key retailers. We don't look and feel like this on the shelf, and also you can't sell to an Australian the way you can sell to a Kiwi or someone from the UK. You also can't market the same way. So all of our marketing strategies have to be tweaked for every individual market that we're in. And I can't stress that enough. Particularly, say, the Australian market is a very good example. We had to radically adjust our voice for the Australian market. They much prefer a more direct, simplified is not the right word, but a more direct communication than New Zealanders and Brits, for example. We like more subtle approach to be talked to. So you have to look at each market and look at how they want to be communicated to, which means adapting your sales and marketing strategy. It took me quite a while to work that out. It took me about 3 years in Australia to work that out. But once we cracked that, and I started, you know, saying things like, let's go for a swim in the pool, instead of let's go for a swim in the pool, everyone was fine. My fifth and final C is common sense. And this one is not necessarily that readily available from what I've observed. So this is all I'm going to say about common sense. It's the ability to discern what is intelligent and what is stupid. And if you put that into your export strategy, you've probably got a hell of a good chance of getting ahead. So conclusion, you just need a bit of common sense. You need some cash, but you don't have to have a lot if you're clever about how you use that cash. You obviously need a lot of courage, you need a lot of energy, you need to be creative, and you need the Cori Lounge. I know that's not a C word, but I'm not very good at spelling. So a little plug for the Cori Lounge, you've got to have the Cori Lounge. Okay, guys, cheers.